Networking, security, and Wireshark.
I'm going to show you two things in this video. Number one, how to capture traffic from an open Wi-Fi network. And number two, why you should never use an open Wi-Fi network without a VPN. Now, an open Wi-Fi network, you've all probably seen. It's a network that looks like this in Windows, for example, library guest. It's a network that doesn't require you to enter a password when you log in. Now, the problem with that is that that also means that the traffic is not encrypted, meaning the traffic between this Wi-Fi router and these coffee shop authors in your local coffee shop is not encrypted as it is sent between the source and destination. So these packets are all actually plain text. So that's one problem, right? The other problem is that in Wi-Fi, you'd like to think that when you actually send the packets to and from the source and destination, that they just go between the two, right? So this Wi-Fi router sends it directly to this machine, and this machine sends it direct to this Wi-Fi router. And that's actually not the case. In any sort of radio communications, the traffic or the signal is broadcast. So this Wi-Fi router sending out a packet, it's going to be sent like this, in an omnidirectional circle around the actual source of the radio signal. And the same thing with the actual machines themselves. When they send something back to the router, they're going to be sending it like this, right? It's going to be broadcast to everyone and anything around the machine. Now, the reason why traffic generally only gets to this machine, or specifically why this machine doesn't see this machine's traffic, is because every network interface card, in this case, the wireless card in your laptop, is configured to only listen to the traffic to the MAC address of that card. The MAC address is a physical address assigned to that card. So it actually gets the packets from other sources, like this machine, for example, or the router, that aren't destined to it. But the actual card is configured to discard that traffic. And so what some smart engineers have done is said, let's actually engineer a tool that will turn off this filtering on the network interface card so that you go into something known as monitoring mode, also known as promiscuous mode. And what that does is it configures the wireless interface to not have this MAC filter, and therefore anything coming to it, it will actually accept and actually look at. And that's what we're going to show you how to do today. And we're going to use a tool in Kali Linux, which is a very common security distribution of Linux, and we're actually going to show you how to monitor, how to sniff, save, and actually look at that traffic in Wireshark. The last thing I want to mention about positioning before we actually get going with the actual tool. What you want to know is that you want to position the capture machine somewhere between the router and the machines that are actually communicating with it, right? So like somewhere like here, if you're at a coffee shop at one of the tables in the coffee shop, the machine can be set up. This is the script kiddie machine, right? He's evil. If you somehow position your PC out here, let's say you're out on the street, say you're in your car, you may see this Wi-Fi network from here. But the problem is the traffic that you're trying to sniff is between here and here, right? It's here going this way and here going this way. So you may see the presence of the Wi-Fi router, but the majority of the traffic is not going to be within reach of your machine. So really, positioning of the machine that's going to sniff is important. So make sure you position here. So let's switch gears now and talk about the actual setup. So the easiest way to get a Linux distribution, as you will need Linux, with the right tools installed, is to actually use a Kali Linux bootable USB drive. I'm not going to cover all the details of building the USB drive. It's actually quite easy, and I'm going to post a link to Kali in the description. But really, it's you need a spare USB drive. You install the image that has Kali Linux on it. You boot with that on the machine that you're going to use, and then you get into Linux. So I'm going to start from the Linux piece with Kali Linux installed, as well as the tools. The two tools we're going to be using are Aeromon and Aerodump, okay? There's also a lot of videos on YouTube showing you how to do this. There's probably like hundreds of them to do it. So I'll maybe post a link to one that I think is good, but otherwise it's pretty straightforward. You get the USB, you boot into Linux, and then you start in Linux. The second thing you're going to need is you're going to need a Wi-Fi adapter that supports promiscuous mode, and also known as monitor mode. Now, there again, same thing as with Kali, there's tons and tons of resources. There's a nice Reddit post here I can link to that actually has a whole bunch that you can get for not very expensive. You may actually have a wireless adapter already in your laptop that actually supports monitor mode, so you can check it out. And then, you know, asking ChatGPT, this person actually here in the comment actually just asked ChatGPT give me some monitor mode wireless cards that work with Kali, and they got a whole list. So do that, get the adapter, and then you've got most of the setup. So let's switch now to Linux. So you've got Kali installed, you've got your wireless adapter connected. I am in a terminal here in Linux. Now, full disclosure, this isn't Kali, this is just one of my personal servers, but I have the same tools installed that you have in Kali. Kali is just one of the ways that you can get to the same point with the software installed that is compatible with what we're gonna do. So the first step we wanna do is actually identify our wireless interface name. So I'm gonna do ifconfig, enter. So don't be shocked, I've got tons and tons of interfaces on this machine, mostly due to Docker and some other virtual networks running. But right here at the bottom, I've got a wireless interface, which in Linux often starts with WL. So I know this is wireless because there's only one of them on my box. I'm going to copy that. Right-click the copy. Now, the next step is I want to run a tool known as AirMon. AirMon is what actually puts this wireless adapter into monitor mode or promiscuous mode. So I want to run the command AirMon ng start and then place the name of the adapter. On some machines, I'm running as root here. If I'm not running as root, in Kali, you'd have to do sudo airmon ng start wln, the wireless interface name. So I'm going to do sudo anyway. It doesn't matter because I'm in root already. You can see here, this will run. It will actually, if you're successful, will tell you that this interface was put into monitor mode and is enabled on this interface name. Over here on the right of the brackets is the new interface name that is created for you. Now with wln0mon in monitor mode, the next tool I want to run is AeroDump. AeroDump is actually what is going to be sucking up all the traffic that's coming to my network interface card now that we're in monitor mode. So I'm going to do sudo AeroDump ng and then start with just the name of the adapter. We're going to add some filters to this in a sec, but for now I'm just going to start with a wide open. And you're going to start seeing a whole bunch of data. Now, BSID list or BSSID list, these are the actual wireless networks that your interface or your network interface card is actually picking up right now, right? BSSID station, these are actual clients or actual devices that are connecting. And then you'll see all sorts of parameters regarding the security and settings of those networks. You'll also notice that up top here, the channel is constantly moving. Wireless operates with this concept of channels, meaning that you don't just have, say, a wireless network, you have a wireless network running on a certain channel. That channel correlates to a frequency used by the actual wireless card to communicate, because not all communication can happen on the same channel, otherwise you'll have a lot of interference. But this is what AeroDump does. It shows you a profile of all the networks that are in the area of the wireless interface card. Now you can see here, I've got a whole bunch on the right, but the data seems to be coming in little bursts. The reason for that is because this tool is changing channels all the time, because it's changing channels because it wants to detect as much as it can around it, right? It wants to kind of get a full picture of everything running on each channel. But if you change channels, you're not going to get a full stream of data. So what we want to do is actually add some filters to this once we identify our network. The network I want to target is this one called Monks, okay? It's an open network. Now, full disclosure, this is my network, right? I'm not sniffing someone else's network, but this is mine that I set up for the purpose of this test. And it is open. There's no cipher suite. There's no authentication. It's wide open. And you can see actually data. This data column shows you the number of actual data packets that the tool has picked up. And there's some data on there. So let's actually, I'm going to cancel this for a sec. We're going to up to run the same command. I'm going to add some filters to it. The first filter I'm going to do is a channel filter. The channel filter will stop the card from actually moving back and forth between channels. It's going to stick it to one channel. The channel that I actually want is the channel that's running this network that I want to sniff. So in this case, it's channel 11. The next thing I want to do is a BSSID filter. BSSID is a fancy term for the actual MAC address of the access point, base station ID. I'm going to copy and paste that in, okay? I'm going to enter again. So now we only have this one BSSID, one access point. So this represents one network, and we also only have one channel, which is channel 11. You'll notice that the beacons are coming in. Beacons are basically like a probe that the AP sends out very often to just advertise itself. And so AeroDump is picking that up. And you can see that there's some data as well coming in here. And we also see a client that is associated with this network. This MAC address is of an actual machine, right? This would be in our example, these machines here that are actually connected to the space station. You can see there's another one that just showed up. So the data is starting to roll in. The last step here, though, is I'm not actually capturing this data to disk. And I want to actually add one more filter to do that. So I'm going to cancel, up arrow. I'm going to add my last tag, which is W for write. I'm going to write this as coffee shop PCAP. And I'm going to do output filter to tell it I'm going to PCAP format for this file. This is going to save it to a file that I can actually read in Wireshark. And I'm going to hit enter. And there we go. Now, on the left here, I've got a nice little SMB browser or SSH browser. And I can actually look at files. You can see coffeeshop.pcap is created, and there's about 1.72 kilobits of data or kilobytes of data. I'm going to let this run. I'm going to come back once there's a significant amount of data collected, and I'm actually going to show you what the result looks like. Okay, so I let this run for a few minutes. You can see the number amount of data has actually gone to about 22,000 packets. So I'm going to stop it for now. I'm going to refresh my file browser on the left here so I can actually pull that file. If this is from an actual Kali Linux machine, you can just go into the folder and, you know, find the file and just open it directly in Wireshark. But I want to actually pull this down to my machine. I'm going to refresh, first of all. So the file opened in Wireshark, and what this is all the data that could be picked up on the machine that was actually situated in this wireless network, right? This machine here, using AeroDump in Linux. Again, with monitor mode on, you're picking up everything. This IP here, 1.100, this isn't an IP on my machine. This is an IP of another machine somewhere on the network. Now, you may not understand how to interpret all this. Part of this is learning Wireshark and learning how to extract data. But just for some really simple examples, if I use the DNS filter to look at DNS resolution, I can see here all the different websites that this user was trying to browse to. Like, that's pretty bad. If I want to look at HTTP for plain text traffic, I can see a whole bunch of communication to web servers that I can just follow on and actually look at full-on web requests between the PC and the internet. So I said at the start of the video, I wanted to show you two things. One was how to actually capture traffic from an open Wi-Fi network. And the second thing was why you should never actually use open Wi-Fi if you have the choice. Now, sometimes you don't have the choice. Sometimes you're in an airport, you're running to a flight, you need to actually use the internet to get information. Sometimes you're at school and the only thing they offer is open Wi-Fi. The solution to that is actually to have a VPN software installed on the machine itself, either on your laptop or on your phone. Now, what a VPN client software does is actually the traffic to the internet. Say you want to get to Google. Okay. The traffic doesn't go directly from your machine through the router to Google. Instead, what happens is the VPN software actually forms what's known as a VPN tunnel. I'll put that in purple. VPN tunnel that goes through your router to VPN provider. And then that traffic then gets sent over the internet from the VPN provider to Google. Okay. Now, the reason this is secure from a perspective of the local network here is because all the traffic between this computer and the VPN provider is going to be encrypted. This is an encrypted VPN tunnel. So even though someone may be able to actually sniff this traffic, like if they're sitting here, they may actually still be able to see the packets going between your machine and the VPN provider. That's all going to be encrypted. There's going to be no DNS, no HTTP, no plain text, nothing. They're not going to be able to see anything. They're going to be very upset. So that is the protection that you need if you're going to be using these open networks very frequently, especially on computers that have sensitive data, is to get yourself a VPN client software and subscription. Usually they're pretty cheap these days. They're like probably about $5 to $10 per month. And have that installed both on your like work machines, your laptops, as well as your mobile devices for when you actually have to use open Wi-Fi. That's it for this video. If you enjoyed it, please like and subscribe. And if you have any questions on the topic we've covered, please join the Discord server where we talk all things network. Until next time.